How long have you been a Rasta?
Well, I've been a Rasta from ever since. You know? But it's not how long I've been a Rasta, it's how long it takes to grow up. Because what he is what he is from beginning to the end. You can never change, because if you even adapt things, later out, you and filter right out. So we're just Rasta from creation, you know? It's not an easy thing to explain in an educated standard way. Still, you have people who can do it. But me is a common sense man. That means when me explain things, me explain it in a very simple way. That means if I explain it to a baby, the baby will understand too, you know?
Marley died in 1981 at the age of 36 and was buried in the parish of 9 Miles in the heart of rural Jamaica, where he was born. In his brief life, he went from a poor upbringing to international stardom, the first artist from the third world to be acclaimed to that degree. He brought the music of Jamaica and his deep beliefs to the rest of the world, from Norway to Zimbabwe, New Zealand to Japan.
Bob's house, right? Bob's used to be living over there a long time now, about 16, 17 years old.
Is that where he lived before he went to Kingston?
Yeah, he was born there, born down the bottom, and he was living up here for a while. But you see, Bob was very different from most of the musicians that were in town. You see, Bob had a part of the country in his life already, which in most of the musicians in the town, they haven't been to country. They don't know what is about country. They don't know about time. They don't know about nature and all these things. That is what Bob really had over most of these musicians.
Yeah, this is the house the father were living. The father were living here. So why is he living here in court, the woman down there?
Did Bob ever know Captain Marley later?
I couldn't say whether he had known his leader, yes or no.
And what sort of man was his father?
He was an Englishman, a white man.
What was his work here?
His work was doing field work in the mountain as a supervisor for the ex-soldier and for the crown land, for the land inside the wood.
Was he well-liked here? Did the people like him?
Oh, yes. He was well-liked here. He was beloved of all.
I didn't have too much experience of the world. I didn't have much about that. I know he was a very handsome, loving, short, just like you see, Bob, gentleman, very loving and sweet. And he told me he loved me, and I believe he did. Yes, he did love me. But because of society and, you know, the amount of talk that goes on and everything, and being, I'm a black woman or a black girl at the time, and he was a white man, seeing is like he just done kill a camel all by himself, you see, and I guess he was like the black sheep with his family.
Marley grew up in his grandfather's house in the country and rarely saw his English father, who died in 1955 when Marley was 10. He was a serious child with a reputation for clairvoyance.
She came in the shop and they always play with him, you know, and, you know, love him up and things like that. And she said, "You're going to read my hand for me today? Because I remember you was reading," and he said, "No, uh-uh." She said, "You're not reading none again?" He said, "No, I'm not reading no more, hon." And he said, "I'm singing now." And she said, "Well, sing what you're going, you sing something, let me hear." And he just came from Kingston and he have this little song. I keep on touching my thing there. And then, you know, he said, "You have two little sticks." And then he start to knock. "Please, mister, won't you touch my tomato? Touch me yummy pumpkin potato. Touch me yummy pumpkin potato. All you do is peel up, peel up. Ain't you tired of squeeze up, squeeze up? Hey, mister, won't you touch me tomato? Touch me yummy pumpkin potato." And then they're just dead way laughing, you know? And it, you know, it let them feel so good. And, you know, she give him some money. I don't know whether it was, what was a trepence or something, you know, but... But that was the time that I see really, you know, him talk about music. That was the first time.
"Oh, man, you said I'm in your place. And then you draw back yard. What make you draw back yard? You know if you draw back yard. Propaganda spreading over my name. Say you wanna bring another life to shame. Oh man, you're just a playing a game. What make you draw back yard? What make you draw back yard? What make you draw back yard? I want to disturb my neighbor, 'cause I'm feeling so right. I want to turn up my disco, blow them the full watch tonight. I
Marley came to Kingston in 1959 to live with his aunt.
Where did you live in Kingston? What part?
East. I call it East Kingston.
Mm-hmm.
Out near the east.
Yeah.
And then we go up, a place named Oxford Street, you know, down to Spanish Town Road, down to then up to Trenchtown.
Yes. So, for a long time, things were kind of lean.
Well, yes, things was kind of lean as can. It leave to what is your expectation and your do, you know? To me, it was lean, but I could understand it, because coming from a country where you learn the things like you don't learn to depend on family and all of that, you know? You go out and you plant your own corn, and you watch the corn grow. When corn grow, you pick your own corn, you know what I mean?
Yes.
All of them fruits on them tree, you can get them, you know? So.
It's a little different, though, in town.
Yeah.
You know, you got to do different things to eat, eh?
Well, when you're in the cities, a whole different ball game, you know?
Right.
People have to go to work, catch the bus. You know, the country, all the day, you go for the donkey, and you ride the donkey to the farm, and you're cool, you know?
Right.
In other city, people hustle, catch the bus, go to work, get off of work, come back home. You know? So it was a different thing up there.
One good thing about music, when it is, you feel no pain. One good thing about music, when it is, you feel no pain. So hit me with music. Hit me with music then. Hit me with music. Hit me with music, y'all. And there's a trench down rock. Say, don't watch that. Trench down rock. If you big fish all sprat. Trench down rock. You reap what you sow. Trench down rock. And everyone know now. Trench down rock. I'll never turn my back. Trench down rock. I'll give this love a try. Trench down rock. Never let the children cry. Trench down rock. Cause you got in Kingston 12, y'all. In Kingston 12 now. In Kingston 12. In Kingston 12. No why you forgot I'm so. Oh no. No why you forgot I'm so. You won't come pull I up. But you can't come pull I up.
Trenchtown is a suburb of Kingston. From 1st to 10th Street, it consists of government housing built after the hurricane of 1951. These distinctive concrete dwellings, built around yards, were to be Marley's home throughout his teenage years. He lived in several and celebrated them in some of his most famous songs. But the Trenchtown of today bears little resemblance to its heyday. Some of the streets have been pulled down and most of the people have moved elsewhere. It's a far cry from the days when Marley lived in the same yard as Bunny Wailer.
We were brothers. You know, we grew up in the same household. You know, we slept on the same bed until we were too big. There was always music. In any corner you go, there was always music. I used to build my own handmade guitars and all that. We used to use the bamboo. And as you know, cut it that you have two joints, and then we split this, the bamboo, the inside as thin as you could get it, and you get the strings. And then we would run a bit of stick up to cotch, to brace, until you get the fret. And we go from there, and you just have music. We used to make it from the sardine tins with board, you know, and use the the wires that were inside of the electric wire, those little fine wires, to make strings.
What was Trenchtown like when you were growing up, when you were in your teens?
I would say it was a magical town, you know. It was like Hollywood. It was full of stars, full of activities, filled with everything, anything and everything that you could think of, that could be in one place. Trenchtown had all those things.
I was living up the road, he was down the road. And there was lots of singers in Jamaica, not only in Jamaica, but in Trenchtown, where we used to live. So we used to gather down First Street, sometimes Second Street, sometimes Third Street, and express our feelings musically.
When the musicians in Jamaica started to play, although them can play calypso too, because they play a lot of calypso, but because the American influence music come past you down there, you know, them start to kind of get more to, them time used to have Fats Domino.
Yes.
And plenty of them type of people. So after a while now, the music start drift from the reggae. So it used to be a music almost like a half blues. And used to play before the ska start, you know. Even people like Joe Higgs, cha-na-na, cha-na-na-na-na, cha-na-na, cha-na-na-na, you know that music?
Right.
Used to play that plenty.
Uh-huh.
So, from there now it developed to people start ching, 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 ching for ska, you know. And then for rock steady, like ching, ching, ching. For reggae now it's check, 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 you know. So you have three different feels. But the three of them can put together again and make one thing still.
In the early 60s, American rhythm and blues was dominated by the songs of the great vocal groups. Their sweet harmonies inspired a host of Jamaican imitators.
At that time, you know, groups were like in the limelight, like the Drifters, you know, the Tams, the Impressions, the Miracles, Temptations. All those groups were young. All those groups were just born at the same time as the Wailers. You know, that we used to get there, we used to get demo records, you know, and to listen from those groups. We used to listen to gospel groups like the Highway QCs, the Caravans, you know, and even Sam Cooke when he was in the Highway QCs, and all those people. So we were really in tune, you know.
The new music offered a way out of poverty, provided you could find a producer and impress him.
The longest liver will see the most. The longest liver will see the most. The time them say are the right time. The time them say it a go dread. Soon come.
It was kind of difficult to get the group to be precise in their sound and, you know, put nobody in their harmony structure. It took a couple of years to get that perfect. But person to person for person, they were capable of leading at a given time because I wanted each person to be a leader in his own right. I wanted them to be just the whalers, able to whale anyone ought to be able to whale.
Now, when did the group, which was called the Whaling Whalers, form as a group?
19, we did, the group was formed about 1961, late 1961. We did the first recording about sometime middle 1962, could be early, you know, which was, the first song was Simmer Down, which was a hit. Simmer Down. We all used to go to church. We don't go to church anymore. We went to church to search, see, and know that we found what was reality and righteousness. We just relax. So when you saw us in our slick suit and things, it's just because we were in the thing that was looked upon as the thing at that time. See? So we just adjusted ourselves materially to look like the thing.
Why did you call it Whaling Whalers? Because, I mean, you know, whaling whalers sound like it's the same thing, really.
But the word wail means to cry or to mourn or to express your feelings vocally with, you know, mourning sound. So because we come to find out that we were living in this ghetto, so-called, with, you know, consist of poor people, 99%. And there were people who living in the, you know, the general shit system who, you know, has no one to help them, no one to do nothing for them. So, and we live in the same administration, so well, we are the only one who can express the people's feeling through music. And because we can do that, the people love it. So we did it.
About Jamaica, and I understand in Kingston, Trench Town is a rough part of town. How did you survive?
Well, while living in Trench Town, you know, as a young man, surviving was easy. The only thing you'd have to really look out for was the police, you know. God, the police could have just get you, frame you, you go to prison, and because you come from Trench Town, you know, Trench Town's from them say, where you from? It's a Trench Town, you're gone. You know what I mean? You get shipped out.
The film The Harder They Come, based on the true story of a Kingston gunman, recorded the phenomenon of the rude boy. Jimmy Cliff plays a character who lives outside of the law.
What's that? You looking for me?
I come to shoot your blood.
Rude boy described a way of life, an attitude of defiance and rebellion against a system in which the odds are stacked against the poor. Rudy came from Trenchtown. Rudy got bail. Remember, he's smart. Remember, he's strong. Remember, he's young. And he will live long. So let him go. Let him go.
Rudy come from Jim Claus. Rudy get here. Rudy come from Jim Claus. Rudy get here.
Remember, he is smart. Remember, he is strong.
Remember.
The Wailers with Peter and Bonnie is like a new sound. As a teenager in that time, I was about 18, 19, and it reflected something on me, you know, for the type of sound that was coming from them, because at that time I was into the church, a Christian, you know, going to church, teaching at Sunday school and all of this thing. So I figure more or less, I said to myself that I should be meeting these people one of these days. You know, if it is, it sounds like angels, and I am being so spiritual into myself, thinking that I would be able to meet them. They were living in the back part of Trenchtown, back at 2nd Street at the time. And I was on Greenwich Park Road. It's usually called White Road, you know, that facing the Calvary Cemetery. So they would pass by through my track every day to go to rehearsals at Coxon's studio, you know. So after seeing them for a couple of times passing, and you know, say, well, they look like, you know, like you'd call them rough guys, you know, to me. That was the impression.
Marley married Rita Anderson in 1966. But although the Wailers were national stars, they were ill rewarded for their success. Such was the recording scene in Jamaica at the time. 3 days after the wedding, he left his bride and went to America. He joined his mother in Wilmington, Delaware, and found better paid work on the Chrysler assembly line.
When Bob came from Jamaica, and he came to Wilmington to live with me, he just got married to Rita then. I didn't even know it. But I heard, and when he came, he told me. And he was madly, madly, madly in love with that girl. You hear me? Bob came to the house, and he wouldn't go nowhere. You know, you have girls that, on my side of family, that would call him and want to talk to him and think, when them call, you know what he do? He hand me the phone, mama, talk to them. I said, how can I talk to them and it's you them call? He said, I don't want to talk to them girls. Then I would have to say, well, maybe you don't feel like talking now, you know. But all his heart is mine and his soul. He said, mama, if you ever see her, you would love her. She is just a plain girl and she walk and roll. Whatever that is, I do not know. He said she walk and roll. And I asked somebody, what the meaning of somebody walking and roll? I mean, walk and roll. You know, she's kind of a knock-kneed. And then the way, you know, if you notice. And he just loved those things about his queen.
How long was he away then before you saw him again?
About 6 months, because he came back in October of the same year. His Majesty came to Jamaica on the April, I think, the 6th of April. And he missed that. That was another, because that was His Majesty's first visit to Jamaica.
Undaunted by the driving rain, a sea of faces awaited at the Palisados Airport the arrival of a living legend. To some, he was the King of Kings, the Lion of Judah, even a god. But to most, he was a mild-mannered monarch who had won the respect and admiration of Jamaicans. The air was charged with excitement as anxious, expectant faces searched the skies for the first glimpse of the great silver bird that could bring their hero to Jamaican soil for the first time.
The people couldn't wait for that plane to come down. It was as if their own power would pull the plane down and put it on the ground for it to land. Before the plane landed, it was raining still. And seven white doves came out of the clouds before the plane landed. Come right down. And as the doves came out of the clouds, boom, the sun came up, booey. Instant sunlight, like an electric light that everyone would say, woo.
In 1930, the Ethiopian prince Rastafari was crowned emperor of Ethiopia. His coronation was a spectacular event which attracted the attention of the world. He took as his title Haile Selassie, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, Conquering Lion of the Tribe of Judah, and claimed direct lineage from Solomon and Sheba. Rastafari is a philosophical and spiritual state which does not lend itself to a simple rational explanation any more than holy mysteries of the Christian churches. He was seen to be the voice for Black Africa against the power of Imperial Europe, Babylon in the language of Rastafari. A religion developed in Jamaica prompted by the coronation. Rastas grew their hair into locks, giving themselves what they called a dread appearance. To be Rasta in those days was to be an outcast from regular society, and Rasta proved attractive to ghetto youths who, up to that point, might have adopted the lifestyle of the rude boy.
So I wrote Baba a letter telling him about what is happening in Jamaica and what we are expecting and all of this. And he was very excited also and said, well, if possible, go and see for yourself, you know? So I said, well, the only way I will say, yes, I know that this man is the Christ, the true Christ that is coming in flesh, because the Bible tells us of his returning like man. He will be in flesh, is if I see that nail print in his hand, because I know that Christ was crucified. And him said that when he's coming, you will see that nail print in his hand. You know, I said, this would be, that's my conclusion on this man. Everybody was looking for somebody more big and maybe stronger, as they would say. But he was just a simple little man, short in stature, small in structure, and as simple as a sheep, as a lamb. So just as I focused my eyes on him now, as he was passing, I said, boy, if I could only see his hand, you know, because looking at him still, I saw that power, because as I looked at him, his head turned around to me, and I was looking straight at him. And I said, if only you could just make a same hand. I was so excited. And as I said that to myself, he did his hand like this. And when I looked into his hand, Joe, there was the nail print, the mark, that black mark, in the center of his hand. So, you know, I said, what? That, you know? And I just turned away my head. And, you know, he went like this and gave a nod, you know, and turned the other side. And so I said, my God, this is the man. And, you know, I was screaming and telling my friends that this is him.
You know, a lot of people are confused about what a Rasta really is and have a very negative image of the Rasta.
my life have great meaning to me. So I really search to find out if God is here. When I search, I look in Ethiopia. I look all about, looking at Germany, you know, because I'm not prejudiced. Me look for God. I look in Ethiopia, I see one man stand up with his name, Emperor Elias Selassie, name King of Kings, Lord of Lords, conquering land of Judah, through the lineage of King Solomon and King David, written in the Bible. One of my things is that the Bible, them say that King James edited the Bible. Now, my understanding is that if King James edited the Bible, I don't think he would edit it for the benefit of black people. When white man edited it, he wouldn't edit it in our behalf.
Were you born as a Rasta? How did that evolve?
The thing that was there, get more stronger, come to Kingston, meet some more people, them people is Rasta. You talk to them and find out it's the same thing I have inside. It's the same thing.
How old were you when this started to happen?
This is about 17, 18, you know?
Uh-huh.
I find out that's the same thing where I deal with, the same thing where the Rasta man talk about. So that is how I could identify myself as a Rasta. By not changing, you know.
Did I hear the words of a higher man say?
When he leave Trenchtown, he came into Bull Bay then. Came into Bull Bay. He and Gabby. Gabby introduced him to Bull Bay then. Gabby Dredd. He's not around anymore. He have a home around a place called Turner, just upon a hilltop.
Yeah. And a scheme.
Then he have another one up the scheme. That way he was really resident. And Judy Mort also come along with him and have a house topside him. So you see Bob Marley, Judy Mort, and Bonnie Wailers. We all, you know, run up and down on the sand, you know, regularly. From there, you know, Jamaki, a little dread, we live there. We congregate there first in the morning time, you know. We cook and we smoke and things.
Father, we call upon thee. We call upon thee. Santa Bull, this cup of Brisbane. Each and every one will take up this cup.
Bull Bay is near Kingston. It is the home of a Rasta community who live off the land, shunning any of the benefits of Babylon. Marley and the other whalers would retreat there from time to time.
When the light flood, Edward says, "Thou art the conquering lion of the tribe of Judah, the elect of God, the light of this world, power of the Trinity, masters of human fate, and the protector of mankind."
God, Rastafari, and I must prosper at Love Jah. Love be within thy walls and prosperity within thy policies. For I, brethren, thy companions say, I will now say, love be within thee. Because of the house of the living I, Jah, Rastafari, and I will now seek thy good forever.
Jah at the kings of kings of kings and Jah at the Congo Natiai. For the white men came and in take I away from my fatherland and in carry I down in this exile land and require from my son. Oh, I will not sing no song at all in this dread, dread land. For if I do forget your Jerusalem, oh, let I write and forget I couldn't.
Slave driver, the table is turned. Catch a fire, you're gonna get burned. To be chained in poverty. Good God, I think it's a little restive. It's only machine that make money slave. Driver, the table is turned. Catch a fire, you're gonna get burned.
He and Peter and Bunny came into the office in London, and the three of them came in, and they were nobodies, but they were like huge stars. Their attitude and the vibe they gave off. And we met, and I really took to them. You know, I took to them this attitude that they had. And it could be conceived, I guess, to be very aggressive or very negative, but I didn't really see it as that. I saw them, you know, they were like real sort of rebels, you know. They were prepared to ready to work, but they wanted to do everything pretty much on their own terms, you know. And so I made a deal with them, which in a sense was risky, which was to contract with them to give them some money to go off and make a record. And everybody said, oh, well, you never hear a record and you never see the money again, and, you know, that'll be that. Because they had a bad reputation. If you've ever seen The Harder They Come, they were sort of like the Jimmy Cliff character in The Harder They Come, you know, trouble. The amount was £4,000 I gave them to make this record, which is a minute amount now, and it wasn't that much then. And a few months later, I went down to Jamaica, and I rang them up, and, you know, wondering if I was going to hear anything, if it was going to be anything for me to hear, and they came around, picked me up at the hotel, and played me Catch a Fire. And I know enough about recording to know that £4,000 was in that record. You know, they put every penny in it.
At that time, reggae was widely regarded as musically unsophisticated, and no reggae artists had been able to sustain a following outside Jamaica. Blackwell decided to present the Wailers in exactly the same way as the rock bands in his stable. Their first island LP, Catch a Fire, had a novelty cover, and the second, Burning, had the words of the songs printed on the sleeve.
This music, which at this point in time was novelty music, I really wanted to get across that this is not just novelty. What these words are saying are words which have a universal appeal. They're not just Jamaican, they're not throwaway words. This man's a poet, really, you know.
Blackwell used all the techniques associated with rock to promote the Wailers and managed to get them a session on the old Grey Whistle test, at that time an unlikely platform for the rhythms of reggae.
When we came to the BBC, they really put us through some serious tests to prove that we were the people playing the music and we really had a sense of the whole music and what the artistic and the professional part of the thing was all about, you know.
Do you think it was something to do with all three of you performing together that would be different?
That is like when the children of Israel are gathered around the Ark of the Covenant. It doesn't happen every day. But when it happens, it's something to write about.
I said, darkness has covered my light and has changed. And has changed my day to night. Yeah. Where is the love to be found? Won't someone tell me, cause life sweet must be something to be found. Out there somewhere for good instead of gone.
Despite the brilliance of the records, the association between Chris Blackwell and the three original Wailers proved to be short-lived.
Can you tell me what really was the reason why the group broke up?
Well, I don't deal with broke up. Because anything broke up never can make up. You see, it's just Oja. Jah put together and Jah put asunder. See, there was a time when we were what you would call imperfect in the music. We was learning the music that comes through divine inspiration, not the one that are being influenced. And meanwhile learning that, we find out that we had a voice that could, me and Bonnie together, had the kind of voice that could decorate Bob's music and makes it beautiful. So we just did that with wholeheartedly.
Well, stop. I wouldn't agree with stop. Because the messages that we carried, you know, were of the same context. You know, we were just messages of the same, talking about the same divine one.
It wasn't working as it was with the three of them. One didn't want to leave Jamaica at all, who was Bunny. He never wanted to leave Jamaica, wanted to stay there. Peter Tosh did want to tour, didn't want to tour. did want to tour, didn't want to tour. It's very difficult to, you know, to work with a band on that basis. It's tough to work with a band on that basis if they're in the same town as you are. If they're 4,000 miles away, it's impossible. I think I was partially responsible, I would guess. Quite a lot responsible, probably, for suggesting that to Bob that one should just really go much more on him as the main guy and then change the name of it to Bob Marley and the Wailers. The first two albums were in the name of the Wailers, and then after that it was Bob Marley and the Wailers.
Marley rapidly became an international star with a triumphant tour of Europe and his first hits outside Jamaica. Chris Blackwell gave him a colonial house, and one of Kingston's wealthiest suburbs found itself with a Rasta community. Today, the house is being turned into the Bob Marley Museum. It records the extent of his astonishing rise to fame and houses the icons and relics of his brief career. Marley effectively became Rastafari's international ambassador, taking the message all over the world. Back home, he attempted to transcend the narrow political divisions which plagued Jamaican society. The two main political parties in Jamaica are the People's National Party, led by Michael Manley, who call themselves socialists, and the Jamaica Labour Party, led by Edward Seaga, which, despite its name, is the party of the right. The conflict between the parties is bitter and violent, and becomes extremely so in the periods leading to the election.
The city is divided, literally. This army post has been established at a point between one area, which supports the opposition Labour Party, and the other supporting the governing People's National Party.
Stop, Jack!
Sometimes it's only insults or stones and bottles thrown from one side to the other. But often it's bombs and bullets. And almost every day, the newspapers carry fresh reports of the previous day's killings in Kingston.
Marley stepped onto the periphery of partisan politics when he agreed to play the Smile Jamaica concert in the run-up to the 1976 elections. In the turbulent atmosphere of the moment, the inevitable happened.
This is the room they tried to kill Bob Marley on December 3rd, 1976. One gunman fired from this position, hitting Marley in the chest and the arm. This is still one of the most unsolved crimes of the century. The night Bob was shot, he was standing right here, getting ready to peel a grapefruit. He heard what he thought first was clappers outside, but what was really gunshots. When he glanced towards the door there, he saw sparks coming out. He decided to turn sideways, making himself small, a smaller target. One shot grazed his sternum bone here and ended up in his arm right here as he kind of, you know, made himself small. Other shots penetrated the cabinet here and ended up in the walls there. Don Taylor, his manager, he took most of the shots that were meant for Bob. He was just coming into the kitchen to speak to Bob and stepped right in the line of the gunfire. So he got about four shots right in his groin region. Most of the blood you see on pictures and Bob's shirt is really Don Taylor's blood.
Where were you hit?
Me? Yes, sir.
Yeah. Went right through? Or just skin?
No, I'm said lodge inside there.
Yeah?
Yeah.
You never saw the gunman?
Well, at that time, no.
But you know who did it?
Yeah, I know.
Were they caught?
No, but I don't call the police. Just, you know, what I'm saying.
The concert took place 2 days after the shooting, and Marley decided to appear. Members of the band were driven under heavy police escort to the National Heroes Park.
But I can remember seeing him walking fast up the step and people lifting him. And by the time we could push our way through the crowd to reach on stage, Bob was singing, already singing War. Can feel the people know now that this man has risked his life for us. This is a man that had given his life because he showed them the wound, the bandage. I had gotten to realize, you know, in reading my Bible, that this man was really Joseph in his second advent. Joseph, who his brothers had sold into Egypt. And it was Joseph who redeemed his brothers, who would have starved to death because of the famine in Egypt. And not only his brothers, but for the world in that time. And I saw in the man that this time he came not only with the physical corn to feed his people, but he came with the spiritual corn, which was the message that transcended to the four corners of the world.
In 1978, Marley achieved what most Jamaicans would have thought impossible. The One Love concert at Kingston's National Stadium was the musical event of the year. Its motive was to promote peace between the warring gangs of both political parties. The show was attended by all of Jamaica's leading political figures.
I'm not so good at talking, but I hope you understand what I'm trying to say. Well, I'm trying to say, could we have up here on stage here the presence of Mr. Michael Manley and Mr. Edward Seattle? Oh! I just want to shake hands and show the people that we're going to meet them right. We're going to unite. We're going to meet them right. We got to unite.
Bob them really see as really the muggle for the ghetto youth, so Bob really come and do a concert that really show the unity to everyone. So when Bob really take Michael Manley and Siaga and join them together as a dread in the miggle now, which would have come in like Christ upon the cross between the two thieves, and say, one love. It's for really show the people of Jamaica and the world that, okay, you fight, say, you defend Manley, and you fight, say, you defend Siaga. All right, so the two of them, you know, one love, so the two of them are hold them hand together now, so one and kill one another over them two man you fight. That is what Bob was doing. It was full moon, April the 22nd, because it was also a commemoration of Haile Selassie's visit to Jamaica in 1966.
Well, he was a real leader, a real folk leader in the real sense. He was really that, you know. He never changed from that. He never essentially changed as a person at all. He was the same person all the time, essentially. When he got his fancy car, BMW, you know, which he said was rightfully his, it stood for Bob Marley and the Wailers. But when he would drive into the ghetto, he would never lock the car. You know, he would just get out of it, even if the windows open or whatever. He never separated himself from the people.
And do you think they enjoyed his success and his material success as well?
Very much so, definitely. Because he was a a generous-hearted person. He wasn't a mean-spirited person. He was a very generous person. He kept about 4,000 people, basically, were living in some way through him in Jamaica.
Marley turned 56 Hope Road into the headquarters of Tough Gang International, the name he gave to his Jamaican operations, and built a record pressing plant, workshops, and a recording studio.
There's some Rasta man who would denounce using the fruits of Babylon, so to speak, to build up any kind of organization.
The fruits of Babylon. Babylon don't have no fruits.
By using the methods that you are using.
No, my father have three sons in the long run. See,
I'm Shem and Japheth, to Japheth and get the wisdom of technology. See? And so right now, technology, we need technology in a sense for really deal with what we deal with. You know, there's no way you can walk this earth here. This earth here is not like when it was in the beginning, when it was one, so you could have trod all the earth. Now you have to really cross a vast amount of water. And, I mean, no one can stop the development. The development is not the problem. It's the flesh, the man himself in his own flesh. It's him is the own problem. If you don't know him, I deal with. See?
Tonight, Rufaro Stadium in the black African township of Harare, where in 2 hours' time, midnight in Rhodesia, this country gains its legal independence and becomes Zimbabwe, bringing to an end British colonial rule in Africa.
Revolutionaries, and I don't want my people to be
cherry.
Aspetti più importanti della filosofia rasta è il ritorno in Africa. Che cosa significa per te questo ritorno? È un'utopia oppure è possibile che si realizzi?
No, non è un'utopia. Per la mia gente, che è stata espropriata per tanto tempo di ricchezze, di cultura e di lavoro, non resta che la speranza di tornare in Africa. Non ci rimane che questa speranza, quello di credere che un giorno, e questa è anche la nostra religione, che un giorno potremo tornare tutti in Africa. Noi siamo per la pace. Del resto, provate a pensare, voi bianchi che avete come riferimento l'Europa, che per noi non c'è che l'Africa. Capisci?
Even though Bob Marley's far from a household name in New Zealand, some people here still refer to it as Reggae music, he was given the usual traditional welcome, usually reserved for heads of state and the like.
Bob Marley, I welcome you to your house of the Maori people. I hope that your stay in Aotearoa, New Zealand, will be a fine one. We're so glad to have a distinguished visitor like you in amongst us in Manawatu. So, no reira, te nākou. In other words, greetings. No reira.
A couple of years ago, no one would have believed that this raggle-taggle tribe of Jamaican musicians would be packing Toronto's Maple Leaf Gardens. It's a sign of reggae's growing acceptance in the international pop music scene. And it's also catapulted this man, Bob Marley, to superstardom. Rastafarianism is very popular in Jamaica, yet in Canada, the United States, it has a bad reputation. People are associated with drugs and the trafficking of marijuana and violence, police arrests.
Yeah, man, them crucified Christ, remember? Christ was a Christian and him crucified Christ, same is not a, what
no,
it is.
No, but let's go back to the facts. People have been arrested, and the Rastafarians in Toronto, for example, have a very bad reputation.
When I wouldn't say that the Rastafarians have a bad reputation. I would say people give the Rastafarians bad reputation because the Rastafarians, all of these things happening before the Rastafarians even start coming to Canada anywhere around here.
But the things that are very obvious are things like the way you look, right? To most people who are very conservative in dress, you look quite strange. Plus the fact that you advocate smoking marijuana.
Yeah, dig this. I'll show you this now. Could they tell God that it's not legal?
No, but you're...
They couldn't tell God that it's
not
legal.
You have a very...
Your last record is very different from the others.
Yeah.
Did you stop fighting?
No, but I was at home with my people, so I didn't need to be fighting no more, right? I was in the camp, and there was no war.
What is your special message?
Truth, peace, and love, and music, you know, and liberty.
In 1978, Marley had an accident playing football and badly damaged his toe. At first, he did nothing about it. Infection set in and he took medical advice. The doctor who examined him discovered he was suffering the early stages of cancer. Despite the disease, he continued to appear on stage over the next 2 years. On the American leg of his 1980 world tour, he collapsed in New York's Central Park.
I was in New York, and he came into the apartment, and he told me that he, he was very sick, and he thought it would be okay, but he was told that he was very sick, and he'd have to go to certain treatment.
Did you, as it progressed, the illness? Do you think it? How far was he affected by it? I mean, how far was he optimistic? How far was he fatalistic about it?
He seemed optimistic right up until almost the very end. Because he went through all the treatment in Germany. I went to visit him in Germany. And
what did you think when you saw him there? How did you feel he was?
I was horrified when I saw him there. Because he looked 80 years old. He looked completely different.
One night, a little before he went in the hospital, I was singing, "I know Jaja will make a way." Yes, he will. He said to me, "Don't say you know Jaja will make a way. Say you know Haile Selassie I will make a way." I said, "Can I sing it like that? Maybe I can sing it in tune." He said, "Of course you can." So then I start to sing it. And then I sing it right through. And then he look at me and he laugh. You know, he just smile. He said, "No, you sing it, you know." You know, he said, he was just trying to express to me how powerful the name Haile Selassie is. So don't just go there and say, "Jaja." He say it sound like a joke thing. You know, that's how serious my son was, you know.
It was broad daylight, and there was this great, huge thunder in the heavens, and the flash of lightning that came through the house. You know, everybody could see it, but it came through my house, it came through the window, and lodged for about a second on Bob's picture, you know? And for who didn't know at the time, because the radio stations had not gotten the news, you know, officially to announce it, but people could know that something had happened and like the heavens was really responding, you know, to like a great force being taken away from the physical plane of the earth. But nobody knew until they heard the news that, you know, Bob had passed.
You know, there are times when you have a good friend and he passes away, you don't even try to even think about what was the past, because it brings back too much sad memories. So you don't matter to deal with that subject.
Well, you know that in this business, there's a lot of singers that come and go, you know. And sometimes when a singer goes, his works go with him. But in Bob Marley, it's different. When he goes, it's like he starts living, because the things that came out of him were eternal. It wasn't him. It was higher than him. It was the source of sound, word, power, and inspiration that came out of Marley, you know, like Moses. It wasn't Moses. It was the power that sent Moses, the controller of power, you know.
What I cannot question, and I have no right to, is the man's death. What are the limitations, or what are the cause? I know he's a very young man, and, you know, Jah worked mystically. You know, 36 is just one tenth of a circle. So we don't know what part him play, but you know, he play a major part in the circle. Cycle of life, just 360 degrees.
Do you think he's still alive?
That's not for me to say. In terms of that man knows not his limit, you know? It's not guaranteed that you're going to leave from a butterfly to from a caterpillar to a butterfly. It's not guaranteed. You understand? Some man say reincarnation and stuff like that. There are all different labels for different beliefs, but Jah know all things best. Understand?
Salam Lekki. Peace be unto thee. Thank you.
this morning. Smile with the rising sun. Really the bird is by my doorstep. Singing sweet songs of melodies pure and true. Singing,
this is my message to you.
All of Jamaica turned out, from the babe on the breast, the school children, and you know, even the elderly, everybody came out. I've been to funeral before, and it was more a reverend and more solemn occasion, but this was like a jubilee, you know. Everybody had a nice time, music was in front, and the procession was going very fast. And I can remember the car that had the coffin broke down at a place called Cotton Tree, and we were there for a while, and we ate, and it was like a outing. I was so glad that I was able to bless my eyes on his birthplace. I wasn't able to even see the mausoleum because of the huge crowd that was there. Even people who had not known him in his lifetime came out, you know, to see and pay their respects to him, you know. It was like a jam session.
Don't worry about a thing. Cause every little thing gonna be all right. Singing, don't worry about a thing. This morning, smile with the rising sun.
But he's not an angry man in that China way. He's an angry man for the cause of black people and all people, but not an angry man individually. But as I'm saying, one of his songs, you give you more to receive you less, which is really funny, but it's true. He give you more to receive you less. Like a feather, but it heavy like lead. You know, Bob lyrics is really real. Since reading Psalms of King David in the Bible, I really don't come across anyone that really get that gift lyrically to deliver really God's message, you know? Because Bob never struggled to write a song yet. As him say, it's Jah write all them songs anyway. Thank you.
out of slavery. None but ourselves can free our minds. Have no fear for atomic energy, 'cause none of them can stop the time. How long shall they kill our prophets while we stand aside and look? Some say it's just a part of it. We've got to fulfill the book. Won't you help us sing another song of freedom?
The millionaire Bruce Wayne, Robin was his ward Dick Grayson, and illustrator Bob Kane created the original strip. And for more brain twisters or mind teasers, join the Brain Game, Bank Holiday Monday on Paul.
Cinema Canada Tuesday brings a darkly comic rock and roll road movie, Roadkill.
Why don't you go on a little trip?
A timid assistant in search of a renegade rock band.
The children of paradise. More like the children of hell, if you ask me. Will you do it?
It's kind of on a quest, spiritual quest.
Yeah. That's a pretty unpredictable thing.
An odyssey of spiritual self-discovery for ambitious men and some very loud rock music. Roadkill, Tuesday at 10 on 4.
You're watching Channel 4 and fond memories of a Jamaican musician whose music and beliefs encompass the world.
No, this is my story, you know. This is my story.
Some people got hopes and dreams. Some people got ways and means.
So if a fire make it burn, not be dread, not be dread now. A dreadlock bongo bongo.
I don't have no prejudice about myself, because why me don't have no prejudice about myself? My father's a white and my mother black. No, them call me half caste or whatever. Well, me don't depend on nobody's side. Me don't depend on the black man's side nor the white man's side. Me depend on God's side, the man who created me, who caused me to come from black and white.
In this a whole sweet life world coming in from the cold. Oh now, coming in from the cold.
Why do you look so? When one door is closed, many more is open. Would you make the system make you kill your brother, man? Would you make the system get on top your head again? Would you make the system make you kill your brother, man? No dread, no. The biggest man you ever gonna see was once a baby in his life, in his life, in his life. Born fatherless, we never know my father. My mother worked 30 shillings a week to keep me, go to school, right? We don't have education, we have inspiration. If I was educated, I would be a damn fool.
Saturday morning on baby.
One cup of coffee, then I'll go. Though I just dropped by.
We couldn't afford to buy records, so we listen to the radio. Anything the radio play is that we hear. So I wasn't really into them things. I was really into, like, you know, call it spiritual music, you know, till it get more revolutionized.
When it hits you,
you'll be okay.
Whoa, whoa, I say one good thing about music. When it hits you,
you'll be okay.
Hit me with music, yeah. Hit me with music now. This is
trenchtown rock.
Don't watch that.
Trenchtown rock.
Big fish or sprat now.
Trenchtown rock.
You reap what you sow.
Trenchtown rock.
And only Jaja knows.
Trenchtown.
The way we work, I like, for instance, now, living in Trenchtown now. I have my acoustic guitar. I'm going to go over where we stay, you know, like in our yard, we smoke herb and thing, and everyone is there, and music start playing. Everybody, everyone influence come into it. A man might hear you sing something, we meet a stranger, and him tell you, sing it this way. Put this word to it, you know? So it's always like the people, the peopleness.
Well, I'm a groover, and the world knows by now,
yo. We just come together about 1960, you know, and rehearsed about 3 years, but the first record in 1963. Well, that time used to have Beverly Kelso and Shirley. Bonnie, Peter, Junior Brathwaite and I. It was good, you know, because, you know, first experience within music, working with some good musician and trying to get the harmonies and everything. It was great. Junior split, two girls split and leave. Peter, Bonnie and Bob.
And everyone know now.
During that time, you used to have one track, you know, everything mixed and record one time, and that's it. And after that, you get a two track, you know. So the studios were really depending on who can hear as the engineer, mix everything. Sometimes it take long, and sometimes them find a mix, and it got you. Reggae music is always there, you know. But the thing that makes our music so important is the lyrics, I think. Yes, it is necessary to understand the lyrics. You know? It has meaning to, you know? But it's because some people understand the words, you know. Some people never go through them situation, you know. But majority of the world suffer. Masses of the people suffer. And this music come from the masses of the people. You know?
This morning, I woke up in a curfew. Oh God, I was a prisoner too. Yeah, could not recognize the faces standing over me. They were all dressed in uniforms of
This morning I wake up in a curfew. Oh God, I was a prisoner too. Compulsory, when you wake up in a curfew, you become a prisoner. Could not recognize the faces standing over me, like all them guys now who stand up over here with a gun now, with the uniform. You don't know who is who. They were all dressed in uniforms of brutality. So, and I say again, how many rivers do we have to cross before we can talk to the boss? I mean, you know, you just want betterness, you know what I mean? And that's why curfew come on out. But it's not really literally burning down the city or burning down. It's burning out certain things out of our mind to live in a one harmony. Created by Rasta people, and it carry earth force, people rhythm, like people, you know, it's really my people working, people moving. Reggae music is a people music, you know. Reggae music is news. It's news about your own self, your own history. Things that you wouldn't really, them wouldn't teach in a school, you understand? Because them wouldn't tell you that Rastafari is God, you know what I mean? And yet the Bible tell you that within 2,000 years Christ shall return, and when him return, him going to be King of Kings, Lord of Lords, conquering the land of tribe of Judah, through the lineage of King Solomon and King David. Now that is a reality of the whole truth, and the truth is that His Majesty is Earth's rightful ruler. And that he is the Christ, and that is Haile Selassie I the first. If His Majesty should come to Jamaica, millions and all the people will come out to see him. I would say to the people, man, be still and know that His Imperial Majesty, Emperor Haile Selassie I of Ethiopia, is the Almighty.
The Lion of Judah shall break every chain. The Lion of Judah shall break every chain. Yeah.
Freedom to me is when the people unite. Freedom means I must be free within myself. My mind must be free. The only way my mind can be free is when I praise Rastafari.
The conquering lion shall break.
Selassie I is the king of kings on earth. No, which guy on earth rich like the king of kings? I don't have a religion, you know. I am what I am, you know, and I am a Rasta man. So religion is not, this is not religion, this is the life. So the teaching of His Majesty is a truth towards mankind. It's not, him don't make war or nothing. It's a teaching, you know. No, this is a teaching, right? As someone who set the example of one must follow and one must live. And His Majesty is the only one, the perfect one who do it.
His foundation is in the whole of mountains. Jealous it's the gates of Zion more than all the dwellings of Jacob. Glorious things have been spoken of thee, O city of God. I'll make mention to Rahab and Babylon, to them that know I. With the old Philistine Tyria, with Ethiopia, it shall be said that this man was born there. And the highest himself shall establish the earth. Jah Rastafari.
Oh!
That is the future. Rasta is the future. See? Yes. Rasta is the future, Skip.
When was the last time you woke up to the smell of cereal?
Give me a coffee in Danish.
You got it.
Hey, Norma.
Okay, I know. One coffee, one Danish. You got a problem?
Yeah. Hold the coffee.
With the Scottish amicable endowment on your home, you can look forward to 25 years of blissful happiness. Well, very nearly.
Natrol Plus Antiperspirant with plant extracts works in harmony with your body. Natrol Harmony. Natrol Protection. Natrol Plus.
Open your first cheque account with TSB and we'll give you a £15 voucher and 10% off anything from Olympus Sport. So you can get that football you've always wanted. Or anything else that might be helpful. TSB. We want you to say yes.
Before you buy your new home, look at the Lovell buyback guarantee. Call us free on 0800 255 255 for details now.
In these new packs, Walker's crisps taste even fresher. But not for long.
This bank holiday, Texas Tom's ripping prices in half. Like this Alicante patio set, down to less than half price, just $29.95 till 8 p.m. Tuesday. And he's got all the extras, too. For the real bank holiday specials, make it Tom's Place, Texas.
Look at the state of you.
You're telling me. I need a trim and edge.
The trim and edge from Black & Decker.
Not only does it trim, but with a press of the button, it edges, too.
Careful.
That's better.
And don't leave it so long next time.
I need a trim and edge.
Trim and edge from Black & Decker. Made to handle the most demanding gardens.
A Princess Reborn. The story they're all talking about, exclusive in The People this Sunday. Plus, revealed behind the scenes bust-ups of Manchester United by the man who tried to buy them. And in your two-in-one magazine, The Great Glossy TV Guide. All the bank holiday and full week's programs. By The People this Sunday.
C'est la musique du reggae de Bob Marley et les Wailers qui a éclaté sur la scène mondiale. Les premières.
Bob Marley and the Wailers.
think is the number one reggae group in the world today.
Yes, you know, come along with me.
Coming musically all the way from Trenchtown, Jamaica, the proverbial Bob Marley and the Wailing Wailers.
The Wailing Wailers, yeah!
Continually, ever faithful, ever sure. Jah live, children. I don't come to bow, you know. I come to conquer. I don't come to bow, I come to conquer. My home is always where I am. My home is in my head. My home is what I think about. How I try to settle my mind in the thinking that I think. That is my home. My home is not a material home out somewhere out there. You know, my home in my head. Thing would I really like see happen. I don't like see mankind live together. Black, white, shiny, anyone. You know what I mean? That's all.
Nation plot against nation, yeah. Brothers fight against brothers, oh yeah. And all of this and all of that, you put them together, you don't know what. There is too much trouble.
Until there
infantile philosophy which will one race superior and another inferior is finally and permanently discredited and abandoned. War. Yeah, you know? So, that is prophecy, and everyone knows that that is truth. And I come out of the mouth of Rastafari. Why one race want to be rich and the other one be poor? Why one want to fight on the other? It's no more of that. The youth of today say, no, that can't work no more.
We don't.
Revolutionaries, you know? You even see myself as a revolutionary who don't have no help and not take no bribe from no one, but fight it single-handed with music.
They will always want to ruin you forever. So if I fly, I make it burn. And blood and make them run. Rasta de Panta. Oh, yeah. So them can't predict the flood. And the lightning. Oh, thunder. Brimstone and fire. Revelation, reveal the truth, revolution. If you don't know, a revelation reveals the truth, revolution. Yeah.
Violence is destructive and degrading. Please help in every possible way to make this general election campaign a peaceful one. We, the people of Jamaica, deserve no less.
I feel Jamaica is a really, is a nice place and is a bad place. You know what I mean? A very good place. But when you have political violence, now when I stand up and I see the youth fighting against the youth for the politicians, then I really feel sick. You know? Because, boy, it's really sickening. Because just because the youth hungry, you know? And them can't get no job. And the people who control the jobs are politicians. So when you find the youth fighting against the youth and the youth killing the youth because of the politician, then me really feel sick in my heart about that.
Here now is a special item of news from the JBC newsroom. Entertainer and reggae star Bob Marley, Rita Marley, and the manager of the Wailers, Don Taylor, are now patients in the University Hospital after receiving gunshot wounds during a shooting incident which took place at Marley's home at 56 Hope Road tonight. Police said the group was rehearsing for the Smile Jamaica.
See them fighting for power.
Well, that was a night, you know, I was rehearsing at 56 Hope Road when cool out there, you know. And then gunshots started to fire and thing, you know. But after a while we hear it was like some type of political motivated type of thing. But it was really a good experience for you, know, knowing that nobody died, you know.
Well, what we know now is not what they tell us. Not ignorant, so they just cannot.
why is still something that nobody really knows the reason why up to now, you know? But we just say, I say the reason is, then that we is Rasta, you know? And what we stand for, because everybody know that we don't deal with politics, neither JLP nor PNP, we is Rasta, you know? And so getting rid of Rasta is the only thing people try to do when they deal with politics, because you know, you're not a voter. So you're like sitting on the fence. So if you're up on the fence, you can get shoot off from any angle, from anybody. Why is still something that nobody really knows the reason why up to now, you know? It happened to strengthen some people. It happened to satisfy some people. And it happened to strengthen me.
You must have done something wrong. Said you must have done something wrong. I wanna know why. Why you can't find the place where you belong. Well, 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 you're running away. You're running away. You're running away. You're running away. Every man think that his burden is the heaviest.
Heaviest.
Every man think that his burden is the heaviest. But I still say, who feels it knows it, Lord? 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 You're running and you're running and you're running away.
Well, my life not important to me, but other people's life important. My life is only important if me can help plenty of people. If me, my life is just me, my own security, then me don't want it. My life is for people. That's the way me is.
Let me tell you something else. Yeah. To make everything come true, we got to be together. Yeah. Yeah. And through the spirit of the Most High, His Imperial Majesty, and Braille Isolasi. We're inviting you, leading people of this land, to be here, to shake hands, to show the people that you love and right, to show the people that we're gonna unite, to show the people that we love and right, to show the people that everything is alright. What you doing? Cause I wanna send the matches right out there. I mean, I'm not so good at talking, but I hope you understand what I'm trying to say. Well, I'm trying to say, could we have up here on stage here the presence of Mr. Michael Manley and Mr. Edward Seattle? Oh! Shake hands and show the people that we're gonna meet them right. We're gonna unite. We're gonna meet them right. We got to unite. Get. Yeah.
mean I'm good. Yes, the peace, you know, is really the youth them in Jamaica started and asked me for really come help and get it together, you know. Knowing that I was one of the victims during the time of the politics. This work, yeah, this peace work, it don't stop. It never stop. We know it never stop. That means we the youth get our work to do.
Love. Prosperity, be with us all. Jah, Rastafari.
Oh, world politics is just things to keep the people divided and foolish and put your trust in men, you know, when none of them can do nothing for you. Because if you don't have no life, you don't have anything, you know. So even those who are the big politicians, they must find Rastafari too, you know.
No woman no cry. No woman no cry. No woman no cry. No woman no cry.
One more one.
Everything is gonna be alright. Well, everything.
we use a herb. Herb is the healing of the nation. Like old alcohol is the destruction of mankind. Herb is the healing of the nation, you know. The more you accept herbs, the more you accept Rastafari. You dig what I say? We who accept herb is important, but herb is more important to the people who don't accept it yet, because that is a reality. I mean, it's not so well then, so well then it's something that you crave, but you check it in your sense and say, herb is a plant. I mean, herbs are good for everything. Why these people who want to do so much good for everyone, who call themselves governments and this and that, why them say you must not use the herb? You see? And we check that and we can't find, we just see them just say, no, you mustn't use it because it make you rebel. Against what?
Excuse me while I light my spliff. Oh God, I got to take a lift from reality. I just can't drift. As a while staying with this riff. Take it easy. Got to take it easy. Take it easy.
Herb is that thing that give you a little time for yourself so you can live, if you use it.
Thank you.
my boundaries. Now, well, I must pick a place on earth where I know I must live. And I know I want to live near my father, and my father lives in Ethiopia. So I must live where my father is. My future is in a green part of the earth, big enough for me to roam freely. I don't feel Jamaica going to be the right place for me, because Jamaica look a bit small. Somewhere new, Ethiopia, adventure, you know what I mean? You can start live. And the only place we can do that is Africa, big enough. So one of these days I stop playing music and I go home to Africa and I don't talk to nobody no more. Nor sing to nobody. Because, you know, this is not a joke.
So, Scott, old boy, when can I expect that package? 10:30 tomorrow morning from England?
Hey, Scotty, you're gonna beam it over? Make that happen, pal, and I'll eat my dog.
Express freighter delivers across America by 10:30 a.m. next working day and by noon on Saturday.
Here, boy.
Federal Express, nice when it absolutely be. Positively has to be there overnight.
Brain Power, a remarkable 8-page extra on how your head rules your sex life, only with your Big Value Sunday Mirror. Buy it tomorrow.
Try the new Zinger from Kentucky Fried Chicken. And put out the fire with a free Pepsi.
The car in front has a unique lean burn engine for performance with economy. Catalytic converters for cleaner exhaust emission from a fuel injected multivalve engine. The lines of its sculptured bodywork are seamless. Its interior is more spacious and refined. Solid doors with side impact beams enclose you in a haven of high tensile steel. And it has the added security of a car alarm and a 3-year, 60,000-mile warranty. The car in front is a Toyota, the new Carina E.
It was a Friday evening, and Joe was out. And the city said to Joe, "Good evening, Joseph. And what will be your pleasure tonight? Perhaps a glass of Beamish while you decide." "The city comes alive," smiled Michael, "when darkness falls." Very clever, thought Joe. Michael.
Hello, BT. Ray Burden speaking. How can I help you?
Yeah, my phone isn't working. 081-464-0291.
Okay, we can send someone round on Tuesday.
Right. So that's a week tomorrow?
No, no.
Oh, 2 weeks tomorrow. I thought you sounded a bit quick.
No, tomorrow.
What, tomorrow?
Yes, tomorrow. Morning or afternoon?
Morning. Tomorrow morning.
Pick up the vouchers from participating Shell stations. Collect all kinds of sporting items, including the Guinness Book of Olympic Facts.
Thank you.
Jah come to break down oppression, rule equality here, wipe away transgression, set the captives free.
Set the captives free. Set the captives free. Set the captives free. Set the captives free. Set the captives free.
When you check it, you know that black people must unite. Well, we know that the unity must start from Jamaica, and the unity must have to start now. Because, I mean, how long would we have to suffer for just learn these things that we must be united? Because once we united, then we won't fight one another.
How good and how pleasant it would be before God and man to see the unification of all Africans. Marcus Garvey said it, so let it be done. I know you know who you are under the sun. We are the children of the Rastaman. We are the children of the I am one. So Africa, unite. Africans, unite. Unite for the benefit of your people. Cause we're moving
out of poverty. Moving
to our fathers.
Marcus Garvey is a prophet, man. Marcus Garvey tell that we must look to the east for the king. I had a lot of things Marcus Garvey said, and a lot of it come to pass. And some still live, and everyone see it. I mean, get more stronger, you know, in reality. As everything we said them time happened today, and everyone see it happening. Well played.
Unite for the benefit of all people. Unite for it's later than they think. Unite for the benefit of your children. Unite for it's later than they think. Africa, await its creators. Africa, awaiting its creators. Africa, you are my forefather upon a stone. Unite for the Africans abroad. For the Africans a yard. Africa,
unite.
Africa,
unite.
One love, one heart, one destiny, peace and love for all mankind. And Africa for Africans, a woman abroad, you know.
How good and how pleasant it is for a night to dwell together in one perfect harmony. Jah Rastafari, who liveth and reigneth with I and I, continually, ever faithful, ever sure. Jah Rastafari, Jah Rastafari,
Zimbabwe. Zimbabwe. Zimbabwe.
I, Robert Gabriel Mugabe, do swear that I will be faithful and bear true allegiance to Zimbabwe and observe the laws of Zimbabwe. So help me God.
Every man got a right to decide his own destiny. And
in this judgment there is no partiality. So arm in arms, we'll fight this little struggle, children. That's the only way we can overcome a little trouble. And brother, you're right, you're right, you're right, you're right. Yes, 'cause soon we'll find out who is the real revolutionaries. And I don't want my people to be contrary.
Dublin politics, I don't know what that is. You see, stand up and talk for my rights, I know what that is. See? And I don't care who the guy is. Because my right is my right, like my life. You know? All I have is my life. Yeah, yeah. All pirates, yes, they're rabbi. And they sold I to the merchant ships, yes. Minutes after they took I from the bottomless pit. But my end was made strong by the end of the Almighty. We forward in this generation triumphantly, won't you? Another song of free men, 'cause all I ever have, redemption songs, yeah, redemption songs. One more thing, emancipate yourselves from mental slavery. None but ourselves can free our minds. Have no fear for atomic energy, 'cause none of them can stop the time. How long shall they kill our prophets while we stand aside and look? Some say it's just a part of it. We've got to fulfill the book. Won't you help to sing another song of freedom? All I ever have, redemption songs, redemption songs.
Bob, keep a talking to the people. They might never hear your voice again. Keep a talking to them for a little while until you're cool, man.
Well, it's to the people have a voice inside of them that talk to them, you know. That is a voice that these people must listen to. Because in everything you're going to do, there's a wrong way and a right way. And if you listen good, you will know the right way.
True.
You know? because there is a voice inside talking to everyone. Seeing?
Sure.
Seeing.
In this life, in the life, in the life, in this whole sweet life, we're coming in from the cold. Whoa. We're coming in, coming in, coming in, coming in.
Only thing gonna can rascal me. I understand that writers and people in the press are very interest concerned about my health. I want to say thank you for your interest and that I'll be alright and I'll be back on the road again in 1981. Recording, performing with the fans we love. Beautiful. You know, Bob talking to you, don't have no doubt. See? Good.
The biggest man you ever gonna see. Was once a baby in his life, in his life, in his life. Yeah! Impossible to go living through my past.
I am not the angel of death, lady. I am the child of life.
Now you're
we use a herb. Herb is the healing of the nation. Like how alcohol is the destruction of mankind. Herb is the healing of the nation. You know? The more you accept herb is the more you accept Rastafari. You dig what I say? We who accept herb. Herb is important, but herb is more important to the people who don't accept it yet, because that is a reality. I mean, it's not so well then, so well then it's something that you crave, but you check it in your sense and say, herb. Herb is a plant. I mean, herbs are good for everything. Why these people who want to do so much good for everyone, who call themselves governments and this and that, why them say you must not use the herb? You see? And we check that and we can't find, we just see them just say, no, you mustn't use it because it make you rebel. Against what?
Excuse me while I light my spliff. Oh God, I got to take a leap. From reality, I just can't drift. As a wife, staying with this rib. Take it easy. Got to take it easy. Take it easy. Scam can take it easy. Tell you what.
Herb is that thing that give you a little time for yourself so you can live, if you use it. my boundaries. Now, well, I must pick a place on earth where I know I must live. And I know I want to live near my father. And my father lives in Ethiopia. So I must live where my father is. My future is in a green part of the earth, big enough for me to roam freely. I don't feel Jamaica going to be the right place for me because Jamaica look a bit small. Somewhere new, Ethiopia, adventure, you know what I mean? You can start live. And the only place we can do that is Africa, big enough. So one of these days I stop playing music and I go home to Africa and I don't talk to nobody no more. Nor sing to nobody. Because, you know, this is not a joke.
Set the captain.
To break down oppression, rule equality here, wipe away transgression, set the captives free.
Set the captives free. Set the captives free. Set the captives free. Set the captives free. Set the captives free.
When you check it, you know that black people must unite. Well, we know that the unity must start from Jamaica, and the unity must have to start now. Because, I mean, how long would we have to suffer for just learn these things that we must be united? Because once we're united, then we won't fight one another.
How good and how pleasant it would be if
for God and man to see the unification of all Africans. Marcus Garvey said it, so let it be done. I know you know who you are under the sun. We are the children of the Rastaman. We are the children of the Iron Man. So, Africa, unite. Africans, unite. Unite for the benefit of your people. Cause we're moving.
Marcus Garvey is a prophet, man. Marcus Garvey tells that we must look to the east for the king. There's a lot of things Marcus Garvey say, and a lot of it come to pass. And some still live, and everyone see it. I mean, get more stronger, you know, in reality. As everything we say them time happened today, and everyone see it happening. Well played.
Unite for the benefit of all people. Unite for it's later than they think. Unite for the benefit of your children. Unite for it's later than they think. Africa, await its creators. Africa, awaiting its creators. Africa, you are my forefather upon a stone. Unite for the Africans abroad. Unite for the Africans abroad. Africa, unite. Africa, unite.
One love, one heart, one destiny, peace and love for all mankind. And Africa for Africans, a woman abroad, you know.
How good and how pleasant it is for a night to dwell together in one perfect harmony. Jah Rastafari, who liveth and reigneth with I and I, continually, ever faithful, ever sure. Jah Rastafari, Jah Rastafari,
Zimbabwe. Zimbabwe.
I, Robert Gabriel Mugabe, do swear that I will be faithful and bear true allegiance to Zimbabwe and observe the laws of Zimbabwe. So help me God.
Every man got a right to decide his own destiny, and in this judgment there is no partiality.
Africa forever.
I, Nelson Mandela, do hereby swear to be faithful to the Republic of South Africa. So help me God. Never, never, and never again shall it be that this beautiful land will again experience the oppression of one by another and suffer the indignity and suffer the indignity of being the skunk of the world.
From state prisoner to state